First of all, thank you very much, everybody, for coming out on such short notice. I know it's Sunday, 3 o'clock, and people are running to get to the airplane, so I'll move very, very quickly. The key issue I think we need to talk about is participatory democracy, and how do we bring the progressives and Democrats together. There's a lot of infighting, and I think we need to have a serious and substantive discussion about what's going on within the Democratic Party. So I can talk for 9 hours on this subject. But I want to let everybody here speak, and then I'll clean up the act. So, two quick things. As everybody probably knows, Donald Trump could not find the truth if he was armed with a GPS. Woo! But one thing we do know, one thing that is not an alternate fact, is that Donald Trump, in fact, is the President of the United States.
That's true.
So we can talk about why that is. I think there's actually people probably in this room who are actually Trump supporters. I want people to talk about that, why that is the case. I want to talk about all the other various issues that people are concerned about, whether it's why people should not be talking about Russia or Syria. But I want to have a very serious, substantive discussion about very, very serious issues facing this country. Issues such as white privilege, issues about the issue of paid equity for women. As everybody knows, women currently make 79 cents to the dollar. It's abominable, it's despicable, it needs to change. For African Americans, it's lower, it's 56 cents on the dollar. We need to talk about, figure out how we can change this. So again, I'm gonna go on and on, but right now what I'd like to do is, I'd like to get as many people as possible here to speak, and then we'll talk more and more about a substantive discussion. Another thing ultimately is we're all gonna be Sean Spicer for the day, except we're probably gonna be a little more articulate. So, without further ado, let me get some people here to speak. If anybody who wants to speak, let's get people up as soon as possible. We'll talk more and more.
Sorry, you want to start first?
Okay, you gotta go.
Where can we get people?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Let me get your name again.
Jim Keady.
Jim Keady is going to speak first. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is Jim Keady. I am from New Jersey. I was a proud delegate for Bernie Sanders in 2016. I came to the conference this weekend for a range of different issues, but one was that I was on the panel discussing athletics, activism, and social change. And I want to tell you a little bit about why I was on that panel. Back in 1997, I was an assistant coach at St. John's University in New York City, with the men's soccer program. At the time, we were the NCAA Division I defending national champions. We were the best team in the country. And while I was coaching, I was also doing a graduate degree in theology. And I started writing a paper about Nike's labor practices in light of what's called Catholic social teaching. And what I found was, if you wanted to pick a company that violated everything that our university claimed to stand for, Nike was the perfect case study. And at the same time that I was learning this, St. John's University Athletic Department started to negotiate a $3.5 million endorsement contract with Nike, and as part of that deal, I would have to wear and promote their products. I tried for a year to negotiate myself out of the deal behind the scenes. I did publicly challenge the university and say, this is probably not a company we want to be promoting. And eventually I was given an ultimatum, you wear Nike and drop this or get out. I held my ground, I was forced to resign, I became the first athlete in the world to say no to Nike because of the sweatshop issue. This issue was first blowing up in the American consciousness. You remember Kathy Lee Gifford crying her crocodile tears when she got caught, and the Nike issue was blowing up, and the United Students Against Sweatshops hadn't even started yet. I became this instant expert. I'm being invited to college campuses all over the country to talk about the issue. And in some of those audiences, in my earlier talks, we would have the neoliberal kids from the business school and the economics department. You know what the hell you're talking about? Those are great jobs for those poor people, and what the hell else would they be doing if Nike wasn't there? I knew from my research they were wrong. The competitive athlete in me wanted to prove them wrong. So in the summer of 2000, I moved to Tangerang, Indonesia, and I went to go live with Nike factory workers, tried to survive on their sweatshop wage of $1.25 a day, sleeping on a cement floor in a rat-infested slum for 1 month. I lost 25 pounds trying to live on a Nike sweatshop wage. And I met these mostly young women who made the stuff that as an athlete I wore for years, and I never thought about who they were and what their lives were like. And I promised them, I will go home, I'll tell your stories, I'll advocate for you. And I thought I was going to do that for like 6 or 7 weeks when I got home. The first year I was on the road for 7 months, I spoke at 80 universities and realized there was a tremendous hungering for people to learn about this issue and have this kind of popular education on campuses. I started a small nonprofit called Educating for Justice, and I went around the country for 15 years speaking at more than 500 schools in 44 different states in 3 different countries. It's actually where I first met Bernie Sanders. He was the keynote and I was the featured presenter at the School for International Training in Brattleboro, Vermont, at a conference on labor rights for a bunch of 8th graders. And I can tell you, 16 years ago, Bernie was hammering away on the same issues that he was hammering away on the stage last night. So that was my formative radicalization in terms of politics, and I eventually would serve in local government in the great city of Asbury Park, New Jersey. If we have any Springsteen fans here, that would be kind of deep. And I am currently running for the United States House of Representatives in the Fighting 4th District in New Jersey. And what I love about one of the major themes of this weekend is this push to go from resistance to building revolutionary power. So this is the athlete in me. I'm a former pro soccer player. I'm a goalkeeper. I'm about the resistance from the back, right? I need to resist every shot that I face, and that's great. And hopefully I get what they call in the game is a clean sheet. No goals scored on me. But if we're just resisting for 90 minutes, the team doesn't win. So we also have to go on the offensive. And the offensive for us is organizing. Getting out there in the streets. Knocking on doors. Getting people engaged in campaigns. And it's, you know, we have to, again, resist and attack. The congressperson that I'm running against, Congressman Chris Smith, he has been in office for 37 years. This is the Republican that is leading the way to overturn Roe v. Wade. He doesn't believe women should have access to birth control. He's on the record saying that homosexual rights are not human rights. Served New Jersey for 37 years, but has lived in Northern Virginia since 1983. Has a small apartment on the western side of the district that he pays rent, and that's his New Jersey address. He's lived in Virginia so long, his kids get access to in-state tuition at Virginia schools. He spends less than 20% of the year per congressional records in the state of New Jersey. The most extreme example, in 2006, he only slept 7 nights in the state. And he has not held an open public town hall meeting in 25 years. Even when we've been redistricted, like in 2010, and we had a number of new towns come into the district, does not even have the courtesy to go to the new towns and say, "Hi, I'm your congressman. Nice to meet you." The guy's been dialing it in from Northern Virginia for decades. And it is time, the people of the Fighting 4th have said, we've had enough. We've had enough of a no-show congressman. We have had enough of a Congress that's being led by Republicans right now that don't believe in climate change, that don't believe in women's rights, that don't believe in refugee rights. We can go through all the issues that we're passionate about under the umbrellas of economic justice and social justice and racial justice. And we've got to take these men and women out who don't share those values. That is the challenge that we have leaving here to go back to our communities. I do want to touch on the issue of how do we bridge this gap between the Hillary camp and the Bernie camp, because it's a big issue in the 4th District in New Jersey. Here's my take on it. So I have a wonderful co-parenting relationship with my daughter's mom. My daughter's 8 years old. It took a really long time for us to get to the point where we're at now. And when I listen to the Bernie people and the Hillary people, when they're in the room together and they're trying to fight it out, the emotions feel like a child custody fight. And the child in this case is the soul of the Democratic Party. And I don't say this flippantly. I am certain that in all of our groups back home, we have marriage counselors who are involved in the movement. And it might be worth pursuing bringing the Bernie folks and the Hillary folks into a room and structuring the dynamic, the counseling, in the same way that we would structure a marriage counseling session or a child custody negotiation and mediation. And I think it can go a really long way, because what we've got to do, I think, to win these races that we need to win, to push back against Trump and to build a political revolution with everybody who shares our values, we've got to focus on the kid in the same way that parents do. And in this case, the child is the Democratic Party and the revolution that we all want to build, to fight and win and have the power so we can put policies in place that are really going to change the world. I would love to stick around. I got to run to the airport. My name is Jim Keady. I'm going to run these around to all of you, my business cards.
And who are you running against?
I am running against Chris Smith. No Show Smith. Or Chris Who, as we say.
Do the empty chair.
We've done two town halls and empty chairs. Right?
This is great. This is actually awesome. No, this is great. Hey, Jim, thanks so much.
Well, thank you, Jim Keaton. And one of the things also that I think we need to talk about, just a quick thing, is what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to be doing a podcast, and the issue is what's called a virtual town hall. So if Chris Smith doesn't want to come to us, we will come to Chris Smith. That means we will have a virtual town hall, and we will have Jim Keaton debate Chris Smith and bring him out. Because a lot of these Republicans have a lot of courage when you talk to them, but then ultimately when you have a face-to-face discussion, they run out the back door. That's got to stop. The next speaker, I think you guys know pretty well. This guy did a great job in terms of when he was in the DNC, when he ran for the DNC. Please give it up for Samuel Roman.
Thank you, everybody. So, who do I got in Ohio right now? OH? Oh, nobody. Okay, works.
I love it.
So, as Levi just said, and
Levy, close to that.
I'm sorry, Levy.
That's okay.
As Levy just said, I ran for the DNC chair. The reason why is because I ran for state representative. And the reason why is because in 2013, the government shut down. And I was active duty, enlisted Air Force in Little Rock Air Force Base, Arkansas. And I see several veterans here, especially Chris Wood, former Marine Corps. I can tell you one thing.
Still a Marine, buddy.
Still a Marine. We did not give up our oath of enlistment, right? We swore to protect and defend the Constitution of the United States. And shutting down the government in spite of those processes, that legislative process, is the most reprehensible thing that flies in the face of what we stand for. And so that's why I got involved in politics. And you know what's funny? I didn't know about the progressive movement. I never heard of Bernie Sanders. I was in my own little bubble just like everybody else, even though I woke up, even though I wanted to get involved and take action and run for office. So for 2 years, I educated myself on what domestic policy is, on what foreign policy is, on what I am doing. What does it mean to be a serviceman? What does it mean to be an American citizen? And what's crazy is that the common sense of everything is what the Bernie Sanders platform is. Universal healthcare, universal education, the basic income, ending tax loopholes for corporate interests, making banks go back down to where they should have been, fighting for clean energy and fighting for infrastructure. And so that's what I ran on. Thank you. I ran on that message when I was running for state representative in the 80-20 Republican district in Ohio. Guess how well I did. I lost dismally, but you know what? Every single time I talked to those people, every time I told them I was a veteran, every time I told them about universal healthcare, universal education, fighting for 15, improving jobs, improving infrastructure, clean energy, the whole nine yards, they were like, you are the greatest conservative we've ever heard. I can't wait to vote for you. I'm like, well, that would be great, but I don't have an R next to my name, I have a D, and they slammed the door in my face. So, needless to say, November 8th happened, and we all know what happened there. Trump and the Tea Party and the fascist movement of the right wing won. They won unequivocally. And so I, just like everybody else, was devastated. What in the hell could I possibly do to combat this? And I'm thinking back to, like, I was asking the DNC to help, I was asking the Ohio Party to help me, please. I'm trying to do the thing, but they couldn't. Not even that they wouldn't, they literally couldn't. And then I heard about the DNC chair race. The chair race. So I was like, fine. If I can't get the answers at the lowest level and the next level, following the chain of command, I guess I gotta go up one more step. And that's what I did. I went to Columbus, I saw the forum, I was unimpressed. I put my name in the hat. I walked up there, was denied the chance to speak in Phoenix, Arizona, because they hadn't heard of my intention to run. So then I showed up again in Houston, ready to drop bombs, ready to throw that gauntlet down. And that's exactly what I did. Because they needed to hear the truth, the unbiased, unequivocal, unabashed truth. They screwed up, they ignored us, and we aren't going anywhere. And they can either get used to it, or they can get pushed out the door. And that was the message. Turns out they didn't like that message, and I didn't become the chair. And now we got Tom Perez. Tom Perez himself, as a person, isn't bad. As a leader for the DNC, obviously that leaves a lot to be desired. It's not that the DNC isn't a great structure or whatever, it's a brand. That's all it is, it's a brand. And we're the ones enabling that brand. We're enabling that power as people who vote, correct? So we can fix that, we can change that. We can take the people that aren't listening to us and remove them. And we've been succeeding. We've been infiltrating parties at the state, county, and even at some of the caucus levels. We have been winning race after race after race. We are infiltrating and we are succeeding. But that's not enough, is it? We have to win races, and we have to organize, and we have to build our own infrastructure. And that's why I started Our Voice. Because at the end of the day, the one thing we don't have as a movement, even though Bernie Sanders ran, and even though he galvanized this country to take action and wake up, we did not know how to contact each other. We didn't know who we were. We didn't know how to reach out and find out where my local progressive whatever exists. And Our Voice is simply trying to create that directory, that database, so we know where to find like-minded people so that we can have our own infrastructure, our own lists, and our own ability to organize and overcome. And to that end, I'm also running for Congress in OH1. Because let's face it, Republican incumbents have gots to go. And Steve Shabbat, who's my congressman, is basically Trump 2.0. He has voted on the wrong side of history each and every single time, and I don't even need to go into further detail other than that. He's also, interestingly enough, a no-show candidate. Someone who rarely ever shows up to Cincinnati. So what does that tell you? Oh, I'm a strong Republican, I'm a conservative, I have my values, but I'm gonna hide away and never tell you about them so I don't get beaten. So what I wanna do for my congressional run is something that might be revolutionary, might be unheard of, might be new, might not be. What I wanna do is a lateral campaign. Jim just spoke and galvanized this entire room, right? I can give us some speeches if I want to, but I want to talk about the things that are needed. We need to support each other, laterally. All 435 congressional candidates that will be running this year need to be working together. They need to be on the same page. I'm going to be proposing legislation. I'm going to have bills on my website of the top whatever issues that I want all the other congressional candidates to subscribe to so that when we win, and make no mistake, we can win. In 2018, we're hitting the ground running, passing bills that will work for you, me, and everybody else in this country. We will pass legislation to the Senate. But also, we cannot forget those down ballot candidates. The mayors, the commissioners, the state representatives, the state senators, the school boards. We have to enable them too, because speaking from experience, as a state representative candidate, I asked my congressional candidate to give me a spot at her a rally or event, just so I can have 30 seconds to say, hi, I'm running, this is who I am. We don't get that. We don't get that at the lowest levels. We must not just run for ourselves. We must not just embody and raise and enable the congressional candidates, the senators and the governors, the sexy campaigns. We have to make sure we all get elevated and we all have our chance to be heard. So, that's what I'm bringing to you.
That was a great Samuel Ronan. next, we got Niko House. People know about Niko House. He's in the house! So
believe it or not, that's the first time I've ever gotten the introduction, Niko House is in the house. And if you believe that, I'm not gonna go there. But, hi everybody, how are you doing? Everybody good? Everybody enjoying the summit?
Fantastic!
Do we have any Niko and Su Casa fans in here? Any Niko House fans in here? I know there's like two. If you haven't watched, for those of you who have watched my radio show or have watched me on video, what am I known for doing? Probably like truth bombs, right? Talk about truth bombs. We handle some objective issues, but some controversial issues. And first and foremost, like my friend Sam said, we deal with the unmitigated truth. And so with that, I want to talk about what we have been seeing. Because I think that social media, if you all have been following, has presented us with a unique opportunity to address an issue that we all need to be dealing with. And that is, we need to find out how to use our differences to unify each other. Because for some reason, well, first, let me say this. How many drag burning people I have in the room? How many nurses do I have in the room? Any nurses? I know there's a bunch of nurse people. No? How many? Any Green Party? Wow. Independence?
Revolution.
Our Revolution? People's Independent Party? No? Okay, so a lot of y'all have a lot of different methodologies to achieve the exact same goal. So I see many of us, or many of you, passing out flyers, doing what you're doing, engaging people in the political process, because you believe that you have a great opportunity to do something that has been done before, and guess what? I agree with every single one of you. Now I'm going to ask a more controversial question, and I want people to be just as honest and just as proud, and I will explain why. How many dim exit people do I have in the room? How many dim enter people do I have in the room? Guess what? I hate to break this to you. Both of you are right. Oh! Can you believe it? Because let me tell you why. In a place like California, why would they dim exit? There are already enough progressives in California to change the entire state. It's already happening. The establishment hates the Medicare for All bill. Be very clear about that. But guess what? It's going to pass anyway. However, if I'm in a place like Michigan, where Democrats were a little scarce, you kind of need every single Democrat you can get, right? I'm not going to answer to the six Democrats that are already there. Matter of fact, you need me more than I need you, so I'm out. It works in Michigan. What works for Michigan doesn't work for California. It works for California or work for North Carolina. But guess what? Through our differences and our different approaches, once again, we managed to unify behind the same message, that progressivism is ultimately our goal. Yes or no? I have media, so obviously I don't start any petition to back up any candidate. I'm not any candidates. I like candidates, I can't do parties. However, I always say, I agree with what you're doing. I agree with what you're doing, I agree. Why? Because at the end of the day, and this is something I firmly believe, it's not about the name behind the method. So the draft party, People's Independent Party. It doesn't matter, because guess what? What we're doing when we break off into these factions that people think are so damning to our movement is we're creating new leaders, we're creating new networks, we're creating new methodologies of training, and we're bringing them whenever 2018 and 2020 comes together again. Because that's what we know where we came from. And although we may break off because our networks became different, we may have had some disagreements over time, somebody voted for Hillary, things like that. Guess what? When the time comes, I have 100% faith that all the differences that we've established will eventually come back to benefit us in the long run. Now, I'm going to say something else. Trump supporters versus Hillary supporters versus the rest of us. Okay, I don't want to put the rest of us like we're better than them, but we're on a different plane. So, if you listen, once again, the differences will tell you how we can unify. When Trump supporters complain, most of the time, they're not talking about how much they love Trump. They say, you're not taking my guns, I want to protect my family, I hate Obamacare. They're not saying I hate Obama, they're legitimately saying I hate Obamacare. Because they, I know, I work in the medical insurance industry, they're paying $6,500 deductible per person in their family, plus $1,200 a month. They're saying I hate the fact that I can't take care of my family. They hear the neoliberal side talking about money, 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 ambition, 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 ambition. In the South, I've lived in the North and the South. They just want to play, they want to spend time with their family, do the job that they love to do, and not feel like they're considered rednecks because they love going outside and fishing and boating and doing the things that people in the South, they don't want to lose their lifestyle. And if you listen, because you may not agree with it, and that may be different from your life, but if you listen, you'll know what they want. You'll know what they're really asking for. That's how we unify. Because once you understand what's different between you and them and why you don't feel as strongly about that as they do, because then you can begin to bridge that gap. Now I have some truth bombs for you left people and progressives. I hate to break it to you all, but we suck at unifying. We're the worst ones. We are. Because we keep skipping a very necessary step. Okay? We are all problem children who were too smart in school. We were kicked out of all cliques, okay? Nobody liked us. We were concerned about politics and put, you know, stop disrespecting my friend, you need to respect, and we had no friends.
Yeah, you better clap, because I'm like, no, I had two friends.
We listen to alternative music, we watch anime, that's what we do, okay? We were in debate. So you have any debaters out here? You have any debaters? Yeah, we were in debate. It was like our own little fraternity. We were closed off from society, but why? Because like myself, some of you are mixed. Like some of the other people in this room, English wasn't your first language. You were the new kid in the classroom. You have a disability. You are black in a white district. You are white in a black district. So when you finally get around other like-minded people, it's an amazing feeling. But the problem is, we still have the issues that we've never dealt with while we were children or while we were developing that we've never addressed. And those issues end up consuming us so that we believe all of our issues are the most important issues in the world. And we fight. And we don't. If you don't agree with me, then you're a hip-hop! Well, bro, I just said that Black Lives Matter and, you know. But you really hear that. I'm sure all of you have experienced this. But you need to understand, just like our differences keep us apart, our differences are why we are all in this room together. Our differences are why we became progressives. And no matter what, whether, and I know y'all gonna hate the fact that I don't care if they voted for Hillary. Because just because we believe the action was nefarious does not mean that their heart is the same. They were doing what they thought was better. But from their understanding of the situation, why education is so important. From their understanding of the situation, that was their best choice. Do I agree with it? No, but I understand, so now we can open up the dialogue to make sure that we all make the right choice next time. So stop letting our differences divide us when we know that the reason that we are here at this convention, at this summit, while we are in this room, while you're speaking to that black person beside you, the Latino person beside you, the Desi, the Arab beside you, different religions, different races, it's because at one point we were all persecuted because of our differences and because of our disenfranchisement. And we all got tired of it. And we will get to each and every one of those issues. But before we can fix all the things that make us different, we have to realize the one thing that makes us the same, that we are all progressives. Thank you.
If anyone has any questions, I want you to ask a tough question to Niko House. This is an opportunity to really, you know, I'm really sick and tired of politicians that pretty much shy away from physical contact. It's like, well, contact. So let's mix it up, let's get into it, and if you have any questions, go. You, ma'am.
So what?
Sorry, your name is?
Karen.
Karen?
Karen from Florida. Niko,
oh.
Florida.
Great, okay.
So, one issue that I've been having to tackle is in my county, which is majorly white, and we have minorities, but they're obviously,
Karen from Naples, Florida. So my sister and I overtook our Young Democrats party, our group, and she's actually 15, so she's pretty young. My question is, how do you deal with people who wanna assist your movement, especially because we deal with a lot of people that want to understand, you know, the poli migra, because we have ICE works with our local sheriff, and our sheriffs make $77 a day for every bed that's filled with an undocumented person, whether or not they're separating families or throwing kids in foster care or whatever. And so how do you deal when it turns from assisting to taking advantage of to tokenism, and sometimes I find myself in instances where I probably shouldn't do that, but then if you already committed yourself, you're not gonna look like
I think probably every that's a big conversation that we all have regularly, right? Co-opting and taking over the movement, you know, should a white person be allowed to speak at a Black Lives Matter rally? Things like that. It's an amazing question. So first I would say, the individual that may be doing this, or the group that may be doing this, find out what their intentions are. Genuinely ask them. Understand what they want to do and what they're trying to do, and then genuinely sit down with them and say, listen, I understand why you want to do this, but I think that it is important that we lead this movement in this particular instance for A, B, C, D, and E. Because our experiences, you know, are indicative of what's happening right now. And as much as you care, as much as you understand, I will never understand what it's like to wonder if I'm going to be deported the next day. You will never understand what it's like to get jumped by a cop on South Beach because you have some chains on. You would just, you know, I would never understand what it's like to be a woman. As much as I talk about, I'm like the probably the most pro-woman, probably single mom, and I love my mommy to death, okay? And no matter what, I tell people all the time, I can never speak for a woman as much as I would love to. And you just have to break it down from your perspective, because I can't tell you from your perspective. This is why this is important to us, and this is why it's important to the movement, because it's not only important for like the optics, but it's important because you all need to know how to lead movements that afflict people who are disenfranchised in the same way that you are going forward. And cool, you may have more experience organizing, because let's be honest, you know, the white people have more experience organizing. It's just a fact. They have more resources. But you need to learn how to organize. And it's important going forward for your movement, no matter what it is, that you can take what you learn from that and move forward.
Can I add one thing? And this is kind of like from a mother's
perspective. Speak up a little more.
I have a bad voice today.
Okay.
From a mother's perspective, and I hope this doesn't sound insulting to you, trust your instincts. And don't feel the need to apologize for your feelings. If someone is doing something that makes you uncomfortable, you address it the way you think you need to address it. Because in that situation, what you feel is what matters. Not somebody thinks they're helping.
Okay, so one more question you guys have for Niko. I know he's got to leave, and we have a lot of other people to speak. Okay.
Can you go in? Absolutely. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. So good to be here. My name is Tom Wells. I happen to be running for U.S. Congress in District 3 in Florida, so...
What's up, boy? What's up, three of you? Three of you! Oh, sorry about that.
I did that as an independent last year, in the last cycle. Got 12,000 votes, $1,000 expended. I talked, my market research consists of...
Be respectful.
6,000 people, and 100 of them were Trump supporters, everyone I saw. So, this gentleman spoke to Trump supporters. Further observations, they have children, they want them to grow up with an education, with a decent job. They are the same as us. They are our constituents. When they say, who did you vote for? I say, Jill Stein. I endorse Jill Stein. This turns out to be not only a moral decision, but also a strategic decision. So, I have a foot up. The Democratic Party has not been unified in the establishment, them to run against me, because they have name recognition. They do not have a way to talk to Trump supporters. We have the advantage. We can route them in every red district. My district is only 13 points. I feel like, God, this is too easy. Because the other thing that he did not say about Trump supporters is a third of them supported Bernie but could not vote for a friend.
What's your name?
My name is Tom Wells.
Yep.
Very complicated.
Can I say one thing real quick? So everybody, just because we're dealing with this issue, and I think as a black man, I'm sorry, but I'm a good authority to speak on this, and I'm okay with that. Everybody has dealt with racism at some point, whether you're on the receiving end or a bystander, correct?
Right.
How did that make you feel? Pretty pissed? Angry? You almost feel like you're helpless? Right?
I agree.
Imagine how it made me feel. I challenge you to understand what it is like to internally make the decision to not be racist anymore while we're dealing with the Trump supporter situation. Imagine your mother, your father, all of your friends, all of your traditions, everybody that you grew up with thought the exact same way as you and rejected you if you did not think the same way. Imagine having your kids not grow up with their grandfather and their grandmother, not being able to spend time with their family, never being able to have the same type of social events that families do, not meeting your best friend growing up because the guy or the girl is hateful. And then think, if you can easily just say, I'm not going to be racist. Politics is the exact same way. And I can tell you, I have a really good friend who's from Alabama, who's part of the Harrison family, who's one of the wealthiest families during the Confederacy. Their family went broke funding the Confederate Army. He cried to me because he was talking about how hard it was for him to tell his kids that he doesn't like his parents. So imagine, I know it sounds crazy, but let's be honest, the South's education system is not good. The people that they are around are products of their environment, just like I am a product of mine. The politics you are around, you are a product of your environment, just like all of us, man. Some of us weren't raised in progressive families. You had to break away. And for some, that is a lot harder than others. I know a lot of Republican and conservatives and neoliberal families that said, when they said they were going with Bernie, they, like, you better get on the train, man. But some people are easier, some people are harder. But it's the exact same thing. And I want you to take that going forward when you're interacting with people and they want to behave and they're jumping because they're just reactionary and reacting off of emotion. You need to calm the conversation down. I do this a lot. Some of you probably did it to me. Message them, call them, hey, you want to talk on the phone? You would be surprised how many times you can change someone by just taking 5 minutes, having a phone conversation and creating that relationship to basically understand from both of you all that we want the same things. Holy crap, I wouldn't have known from your post because Facebook and politics have become pop culture. So the popular things get shared, but the real issues never get discussed. So thank you all so much for having me. I appreciate it.
effort. Katie Steele Burrow.
Experience, and it's not in politics. It's experience in paying for college. It's experience in working a full-time job and trying to find childcare. It's experience in being married to an immigrant, and being a teenage mother and trying to find an option for healthcare for me and my family. So having this experience and having the experience of the 2016 Bernie Sanders campaign had me pretty upset come November 6th, November 8th, right? You know. So I show up to my first staff meeting after that, and I start asking for answers. I want to know if they knew what was right, and if they had such a great plan, how we ended up with President Trump. And they didn't have any answers. And so I decided to stick around, and I keep trying to show up, and I keep trying to make a difference there. And by showing up, it's not showing up to the DNC Convention Center that you guys see on TV. When you show up to a local meeting, a lot of you probably already know this, it's 10 people in a UAW hall. So to make a real difference on a local level, you only need 11. No. Just 11. That's it. They don't want to give you 11. They don't, and they'll fight you every step of the way. And what I found is the best way to bring us together is to unite on those issues. And if you look into the people that are currently leading, and you start to hold them accountable for giving, you know, the type of representation that we expect and we deserve, you'll see that right now a lot of the Democrats are sadly lacking, and they don't have a reason for that. They don't have an excuse. What they have is, well, we've always done it this way. Well, we've always done it this way, so we're just going to keep doing it this way. And they'll ignore their own rules, and it's okay because that's what they've always done. And that's not acceptable. It's not good enough for you. It's not good enough for me. We need better. So we have to keep showing up. We have to show up together. So this is my favorite. I got this from Nina this morning. After you show up, if you decide to run for office, if you get a title, remember, it's Nina Turner. Titles are good, but purpose is better. We have to keep a vision in mind, and that vision has to be what drives us. And we can't get lost in the next election. We can't get lost in winning the next seat. We have to keep that vision in mind and realize that when we walk into a meeting and there's 10 people sitting there, we're not representing ourselves. We're representing the thousands of people that are at work that night. They can't come because they can't get a babysitter. They don't have a ride. They're not on the bus line. So we got to go in there and keep that in mind. And that, to me, is we can't let things like, she said Russian metal, then I don't believe it, so she's not on my team. We can't let these things split us up. I get we all have different perspectives on what happened, but we don't have the inside information. We don't have all of it. We can't make those decisions, and we can easily let that stuff tear us apart to where we're all completely ineffective. We don't need to do that. If we hold them accountable, and I don't know if you guys have read the news this weekend, but in my state, in the Michigan Democratic Party, recently, yeah, they were levied a $500,000 fine, and the news just broke this weekend because they weren't documenting their campaign contributions properly. They were taking more money than they should have, and then they were writing fake names and attributing them to fake people in order to cover it up. This happened 2 years ago. We've got new leadership since, and a lot of the reasoning that I've heard for this over the past 2 days is, well, that was the old guys. That's the old guys. We got to suck it up. We got to make this money. We got to get ahead. And I don't accept that. That to me sounds like a Trump excuse. We don't have any right to go to Trump and say, okay, we got to hold him accountable when we're not holding ourselves accountable. I honestly think that we have the passion, and we have everything we need on our side to win. We just have to believe that and show up. If we believe that and show up, I'll tell you right now, we're relevant. We're more relevant than any of us know. They show up to our local progressive meetings, you know, people that are Democrats, because they want to know what we're up to. Yeah. And that's how we know that we're relevant. We keep showing up. We formed our own county progressive caucus. So you can't just do it from inside and you can't just do it from outside. You have to show up and you have to organize outside and then bring it back inside. If they're not working with you, like a lot of people in our state have had a hard time, organize your own caucus. You know, get together and have meetings and plan on group efforts to walk in and make change. It's not that hard. Like I said, it's 10 people. They have 10. We only need 11. Thank you, guys.
Oh, that was fantastic. You know what? We'll go over the, ma'am, what's your question?
No, I just wanted to make a comment. I'm from the party that Casey's with. I moved from Flint to Grand Rapids. I'm part of the progressive meeting. And I just want to say my very first vote was for a woman of integrity, Shirley Chisholm in 1970.
Woo! Good job! Please give it up for Michelle Warren. Actually, Michelle and I were running about 4 hours of sleep. We literally had about a 5-hour discussion about participatory democracy.
Start having some conversations among ourselves and you know, in the shower, or things to your left, you know, what do we count as a victory in the demonstrative process? It may not be who wins this chair. We're not going to win that one very many the first go round, I don't think. We're not doing so good on that one quite yet. But in our state, at our state convention, we tabled an amendment that a DNC emeritus, his wife, wrote. We tabled the party. We organized and we had a social media campaign. I wrote an open letter to our state executive committee. I became the state executive committee's next meeting agenda item. I did. And we tabled that that rule change proposal before it ever even got to like three discussions. And it would have totally changed the way our county conventions were held. And it was going to be like, you walk in and there's a slate and everybody just goes, say your name, and that's it, there's county officers. When we worked with our revolution to text out for delegates, they had an emergency conference call about all these strangers calling in to be delegates. They were scared. They were like, oh crap, who are these people? And they're coming for us. So that, in South Carolina, we scared them. That's a victory. We got our butts handed to us on the Who Won State Chair. But we scared them, and we got a resolution table. So, you know, that's a victory. So we really have to, I mean, I'm aiming here every time. I mean, I'm aiming here every time in all 50 states, all 7 territories, and in abroad. And Jason and I like talk to the people all over the country all the time. So we're keeping tabs on what's going on everywhere. And every time we're aiming here. But we also know that down here is a lot of those battles we're winning too. And if nothing else, when you see their response to something we initiate, take that as a victory. That's a sign. If we weren't doing something right, if we were not doing something right, they would not be kind of having no shit on it, basically. and the other thing is, remember that even when we start getting seats at the table, we're not going to have all the seats yet. So you're going to have some leftover people there still. And so the second part of the demonstrating process is you got to sell your ideas to the people that are still sitting there. So you're going to have to talk to them. You're going to have to put, you know, some bygones, and you're still going to have to talk to them and sell your ideas to people that are there. So it's not just showing up, but it's showing up, being prepared, and conversing with the people that are already there. And then I told them I would introduce the next two people.
Oh, okay, but I'm going to ask, one quick question.
Okay.
Is Nita and Drew amenable to have somebody else ahead of time, only because they have to leave? Josh, are you guys okay with that?
Oh, yeah. All right,
appreciate
that. All right,
Josh. Josh Copeland, I don't know very well, but he's phenomenal. He's doing phenomenal work for the local Bernie-crats, please do a warm welcome to Josh.
So I'm representing local Bernie-crats. Some of you I know what local Bernie-crats is. It's a organization on Facebook. I started about a year ago, and I'm here to spread the singular message. We have a singular focus, and that's to encourage each other to run for local office. But here at the summit, I'm here to spread this message, especially if you're in the progressive media. But one of the problems that we're having with divisions or with just not making enough progress and victories is that we need to discuss the solution rather than all of these national issues, national candidates, national or divisive squabbles. We kind of also have to talk about the solution, right? Which is local offices. If you notice, if you go online, if you listen to people talking about politics, it's almost all about national issues, national candidates. So our message is, well, let's all focus and talk also about the solution, which is running for local office and encouraging folks to run for local office. That is the bottom up, that is the foundational level of bottom up revolution. And so As progressives, I think we needed a new narrative. If I may be so bold as to say, we need a narrative for progressives, and that is, let's talk about the solution when we talk about the problem as well. And that is, let's talk about, let's remind each other to talk about local offices and encouraging folks to run for that. So I've been going around to all of the progressive media that's here and making this bold suggestion that we make a new progressive narrative. But I sincerely feel like everybody here knows that. And I'm not accusing anyone here of forgetting about local politics. Our revolution's been doing wonderful things. We've all been active in this revolution. But we all have to remind ourselves and everyone else to also talk about that local stuff, okay? Because, I mean, it kind of gets forgotten, am I right? So I believe that if we all progressives were to remember that and to actually talk about local when we talk about everything else, man, I think we're going to make a lot of progress. A lot of people are going to get on the ballot. A lot of progressives will win. Just as a fun example, okay, and this is just a loving criticism of, let's say, Bernie Sanders, for example. If you look at his Twitter feed or if you look at his Facebook, social media, you go back month, 2 months, 3 months, you actually won't find very many, I would say you won't find any posts that say the words, quote, run for office or run for local office. Try it. That's not Bernie forgetting about us or turning his back, it's just we all need to be reminded to talk about the local stuff too. So I'm also here to send a message, if anybody can send a message to Bernie Sanders.
I think I might be able to just maybe. Yes!
We need more posts about the solution of local politics, local offices. Encourage each other to run for a local office. So that's it. That's my very simple and concise point. Thank you very much.
All right, guys, I know Nita and Drew are next. I don't know if there's any way you can give me. One other person has to leave. You okay with that? Alright. I apologize, but I had to use my assertive skills. It's assertive 101. So, alright, sounds good. So, the next speaker is Daniel DeRiso.
So, I really want to talk about making people in their communities feel empowered. And so I work for Randall Woodfitt, who is running for mayor of Birmingham, Alabama. I also worked in the Bernie campaign in Alabama, which we lost by 82 points. So obviously that is, like, why did our message not resonate at the time, right? Like, what was happening that our message wasn't resonating with the people in the communities, especially even in Birmingham, which is a very, very blue state, or a very, very blue city, we still lost it by about the same margin, right? So, what I found on this mayor's race is that our message does resonate, and that last year, people didn't know who Bernie was, even when they went out to vote in Alabama and in the South, right? A lot of people don't have the time, especially a lot of the Democratic voters in Alabama don't have the time to stay extremely involved in politics, right? So they voted for the name. A lot of them voted for the name that they knew. But on this race, empowering people in their communities. Who in here wants to run for office? Who in here wants to help someone run for office? I think that was pretty much every hand. If you're a progressive and you're running against an establishment candidate, the media might ignore you. They did with Bernie. For a long time last year, the big organizations in your city or your county or your state might ignore you because they're in favor of the establishment candidate. But you can get your message out. And what I found, and I worked on Tim Kennedy's race last year as well, is that that race, we have one of the most amazing teams of people going out and talking to voters every single day. And some of them are in this room right now. So, we've jumped about 20 points in the polls in about 2 months. And a lot of that is attributed to people going out and talking to people face to face and asking them about what they care about and how your candidate or you, yourself, if you're running, are going to address that issue, right? So people spend money on television ads, people spend money on you know, they get their endorsements, whatever, whatever, but a lot of candidates don't go and talk to people face to face. And this is something that sets my candidate, Randall, apart, is he goes out and knocks on doors every single day, right? So what I'm really trying to stress here is that when you're going out and talking to voters, right, you might find some people who are saying, hey, I'm not going to vote. My voice doesn't matter. I can't change anything. Right? And that's a really discouraging thing to find in people. And what we need to do is make sure that those people feel like their voices are heard. So that's why you go and you talk to them face to face. And you aren't talking to them through a box, right? That just comes on the local news every night. You're talking to them personally about the issues that matter to them. So you might, your opponent might have all the money in the world, but if you have the people and the energy behind you to go out and talk to other people, you can build a movement that can change everything wherever you're running. So through that, that's how you can get your message out. That's how you get your name idea. That's how we build a movement that wins, right? And I just want to take, does anyone have any questions about door knocking or phone calls?
Let me just cut in one thing good at this one. Are people aware of what's going on in Birmingham, Alabama? This is extraordinary. Virtually nobody knows it, including mainstream media, even non-mainstream media. What's incredible? In Birmingham, Alabama, as you guys know, there are certain states in the country that do not have minimum wage. Alabama does not have a minimum wage. We are in 2017, no minimum wage. So what that means, it reverts back to $7.25 an hour. So Birmingham, Alabama decided they were gonna take this to the streets. And they said, you know what, unacceptable. The city council got up to $10.10 an hour. $10.10 an hour, came in this. And then ultimately what occurred is a progressive folks from Alabama said, no, sorry guys, we're 2017, not going to allow this. And what did they do?
Back to 7:25 an hour, correct?
The Republicans wrote it in the state legislature.
So the Republican state legislature put it back to 7:25 an hour. If Alabama could change the minimum wage up to 10-10 hour, that would be extraordinary. And what that would do to the rest of the country would be absolutely unbelievable. So ultimately, what I hope you guys are doing is start calling folks in Alabama and demand the fact that Birmingham, Alabama have a 10-10 hour, and then obviously we're going to get up to $15 an hour. Thank you.
That is an interesting issue. So people in the Republicans are so enamored by states' rights, didn't give our city rights, right? We raised our wage to 10-10 an hour, and David Faulkner of District 46 in Mountain Brook, Alabama, wrote a bill taking that away. And Governor Robert Bentley, the love gov, signed the bill. Randall believes in a $15 an hour minimum wage, and We can't enact that policy unless we vote people into the state legislature that'll change the law that Dan Fulton wrote. So, again, you know, no candidate can do everything, but this movement can do everything. You guys can do everything. And I'm extremely proud to be part of this with you. If you have any questions, let me know.
Guys, you have a really good opportunity to ask this guy some tough questions. So let's make this guy sweat. All right, go for it.
Yeah, so, guys, yeah, so I definitely want to address this, right? So, like, honking waves, all that stuff, it's fun stuff, right? From what I see in the numbers, what is 10 times, maybe even 100 times more effective than that, is if you can go in and knock on doors and leave a little bit of time. Because then people know that you visited them. And, like, we're all politically inclined. We see yard signs, we see candidates, and we think, oh wow, you know, they're doing well, right? A lot of people don't, they just don't care. They don't care about the yard sign that their neighbor has, or they don't care about the billboard that's up. You know, they care about what this candidate is going to do for them, right? And that's why, like, the personal interaction thing, I will always 100% say that the contact is great. But, like, that is awesome, and I'm really glad that you got involved in that way. And so you were in Grand Rapids.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hey, guys, just one more question, because unfortunately we got a lot of other people.
Yeah,
so, I can answer your question later if you want. And
we will ask a question for the speaker.
Yeah, and you have a speaker too? All right, okay, that's fine. Go for it.
So I'm running for but my district is actually evenly 40% delegated. There's a 30% Democrat and 20% like Republican.
That's
one of the issues I'm having with the Democrats, more than the Republicans, is when they open their door, they're like, I'm voting Democrat, and they shut their door on me immediately. Now, do you have any suggestions for any good vote lines? And would you, as a candidate, would you be considered in their mailbox even after they
So don't put any literature in people's mouths.
That's a
federal
offense.
Please don't get that as a federal offense.
Yeah. So, I could talk about this for hours, but, you know, there's an easy... Some people won't be receptive at the doors, right? You can turn a refusal into data real easy. Well, hey, are you just planning on voting? If they say they're planning on voting, that's an undecided, right? Like, if... So you're running unaffiliated.
I'm independent.
You're so independent. And there's is there a Democrat running?
There's the two incumbents are Democrats, and there's two Republicans also. So, right. So the leader in the assembly is a field and the top two candidates in the general assembly in that district.
So ask people what issues matter to them. That introduce their personal stake in the election and how you're going to change things. Right? That's how you can hook people in. And some people, you know, not every contact is going to work, right? People are going to shut the door in your face, and that's fine, right? There are other people that won't, and they'll talk to you, and you'll learn a lot from them.
So should I not introduce myself as an independent and just go sheer and
do an A/B test? See what works better. Introduce yourself. You are you. You know? Introduce yourself as you, I would say.
All right, guys. I that's great. I'd love to people talk more, but we got to get to some other people. But
If you guys want to check out Randall Woodfin, you can find Randall Woodfin for mayor on Facebook or randallwoodfin.com. And we'd love to have you phone bank for us. Maybe contribute like around $3 to be pretty cool. But you guys are awesome, and thank you so much for the honor of me being able to speak here.
Thank you, Daniel.
All right, so now we're going to allow somebody else to introduce the Nita and Drew Show. Woo! Sanders and anybody else here, we do it. But this is an incredible crowd. I literally started this on Tuesday without literally any type of media, and you know, we have a great crowd, and I'm, you know, really, this is very exciting. So congratulations, guys.
Yeah. So like I said, my name is Drew, and this is Nita. I'm a 22-year-old millennial. And Nita right here is Bernie Sanders' age. And we have a little treat for you guys today. Because politics needs to be fun, and it needs to be passionate, and people need to be engaged. So we just have a little treat we want to do real quick for you. But we do that because I hold Nita up, and Nita holds me up. And, you know, a lot of people say, you know, the older generation needs the millennials. The millennials need the older generation. We need each other. And Nita has so much advice. And I give a unique perspective as well, too. And I think what really drew people to Bernie is because he's passionate. And this woman right here is so passionate. Like, she works so hard every single day, and she inspires me. And I hope that I inspire her too, because we're in this together. And so I think, you know, we really need to utilize our resources. And if you're an older person and you're going to these meetings and you see young people, please talk to us. Because I know so many young people who are interested in running for office, but they're like, I don't have time, you know, I gotta work, I have school, I have all this homework. Younger people need a whole lot more volunteers. Like, we need people behind us and people who are gonna help us. Especially people who have advice and experience. So when you go to these meetings and organizational things, please talk to the young people. Please help us stay in the game, because we really need that encouragement. I'll let Nita talk a little bit too.
And by the same token, as older people, is for us to listen to the younger people. Yeah. As older people, we have some wisdom because of life experiences, but the younger people have so much to teach us. I have learned so much from Drew and from the younger people. We were both Bernie delegates. We were both Bernie delegates from Colorado. He came back pretty wounded, very wounded, took a couple of breaths, and then got out there. And for myself, or for me, what I did was work with our revolution on getting local candidates elected, on getting, trying to get Amendment 69. It's the best effing amendment that there was. we didn't make it this time, but then the group formed a nonprofit, so we have not stopped.
It's for single payer.
And single payer, we're going to do it. And then what we did also with Dem Enter, which was just absolutely incredible, because we did have establishment in our state party, and we changed it. We got a chair who got, what was it, 95% of the vote?
Endorsed by our revolution.
Endorsed by our revolution. This is for our state Democratic chair. We got a second vice chair that is a millennial, or first vice chair. Then, for our second vice chair, we had two establishment people running. And Miguel over here called me two nights before, Miguel Severius, called me two nights before and he said, Nita, I think I'm going to run for second vice chair. Would you stand up and nominate me? And I said, well, yeah, but we got to get some flyers made for you. So we got flyers. Guess what? On the first vote, it was split three ways. How many votes did we have to do? Four?
There was three votes.
Three votes. And then finally they said, well, all right, we've got to figure something out. They suspended the meeting. And the three met, and we changed the rules, and guess what? We have three second vice chairs. So we really turned our Colorado. Thanks to Dan Henry, thanks to our revolution, and I give a big plug for our revolution, because honest to goodness, we formed a local chapter. This is our team. We have a lot of autonomy. We get to pick what candidates we want. We endorse those individually. You can do this in every one of your cities. Then we send that up to our revolution, and our revolution will vet and do endorsements too. So stay involved. Stay involved. And thank you.
Great. Was that tremendous strength? That was extraordinary. Congratulations. I'm a yogi guy. I don't know if I can do that, actually. Next, please do a warm welcome to Anj Graver.
Something that inspires
the people summit, I was asked, what was it lacking? What was it lacking? That's what I've been asked by a lot of people. And, no, it was what it was. It was a beautiful summit in which everybody got together and got to voice their opinion. You didn't have to be someone special to talk to everybody in here. You don't have to be someone special to stand up here on a mic. So you can voice your opinion, speak with your, I'll use this word wisely, comrades. But we can absolutely create the change we need because we can demand it. And we are in this together. We aren't just people here listening and trying to do. We are 5,000, 4,000 people who are here, who are organizers. And we're going to go back and take that message back and fight harder. Thank you so much.
Just tap go live and keep it horizontal.
Let me just say real quick what this last speaker just said. I don't know if you guys know about it, but Rick Scott literally does not believe in the concept of climate change. But it's deeper than that. This guy doesn't even allow people, my understanding, in government to talk about climate change. Talk about a real courageous individual.
Sustainability.
What is quite remarkable, which is unbelievable, is I think the Republic of Ours don't understand that we only live in one world. I don't know what goes on. They literally, Donald Trump has not even admitted the fact of whether or not he believes in climate change. Doesn't even have the courage to admit that he doesn't. It's an outrageous, unbelievable thing. But we will continue to push forward, and you know, we will succeed. So let me do it. So our next speaker, sorry, good question. Yep.
I have a question for the previous speaker.
Okay.
My question is, we just formed our revolution in groups in Southern Oregon, and we've been out about 11 weeks, and we're looking at, and I'm really glad to hear the kind of relationship we can have with the national organization, supporting us to recommend candidates. What about the 501c4 aspect and fundraising? If we would prefer not to do that yet, can we work with you to raise funds for a local candidate, or how does that work?
I know that we were told that we could go either way on it, which our group has chosen just to stay grassroots and not do the fundraising. So the national organization has left it up to the individual group.
Well, what if people vote if they want to make a donation and they just would do it too?
They don't
guys, I'm sorry, we're really running out of time, but here's the thing. We're running out of time. I want to get it through.
They don't do it through us.
If you guys want to talk back and forth, 5 seconds. I want to get everybody here. Please, by all means, you can talk to her afterwards and exchange information. That's the beauty. We are in social media. All right. So the reality is, it's okay. So I'm sorry, Joe. I just got a new one. So the next speaker is Alan Pugh.
Standing still.
Yes!
So, first thing I wanted to say is we found something stronger than coffee when we got here and heard Nina speak this morning. I've never been so alone. Fortunately, not the first time that I've heard from her. She's over in Cleveland and I'm in Elyria, Ohio. I'm running for city council at large. This is my first time running for office, and if you had told me 2 years ago I was going to run for office, I'd think you were crazy. This is not something that I saw myself doing. I have a lot of strong political opinions, but the way that I tended to express those was through very angry rants on Facebook. I'm sure that there's a few of you in here who have done a little bit of that. I was a big fan of Bernie Sanders, of course. Goes without saying. But when he decided to run for president, the first thing that I did is I said, well, I'm going to put all of my heart and soul into this. We opened up a volunteer-funded office for him in Elyria, Ohio, a little bit west of Cleveland. We had volunteers knocking on doors. We had volunteers making phone calls. We were not affiliated with the campaign. We were fortunate enough to get dozens of people without the campaign's help to come and work for him, which really tells you what kind of a movement this was. And it was age-wise, it was a very diverse movement. Unfortunately, this is something that I wanted to talk about because Niko brought this up earlier about talking and listening. The movement, while it was diverse in age, was not diverse in many other ways. when I heard that we were over 50% people of color at this event, it gave me a lot of happiness because I've been in so many white rooms, just completely white rooms, and we're finally getting that outreach, we're finally bringing people together in a way that I have not seen. So we've been talking a lot over the weekend about how to communicate with people that are not yet part of the movement, or even as Niko said earlier, the debaters, the people that are part of the movement, the people that are sometimes, you know, hard to, we butt heads sometimes. The hardest thing to do, let me ask this, has anybody in here ever given a job interview, like they've been the one asking the questions for a job interview? When you ask that question, you have a little sheet in front of you with that list of questions, right? You ask and you're kind of listening and writing down, but you're also already looking down at the next question. That's what we do in these political debates, and that's one of the problems that we have is we're already thinking about the next question that we're going to ask. And what that means is we hear the words that they're saying, but we don't hear what they are saying. We don't hear the meaning of what they're saying. And that really holds us back. We need to learn to ask questions and then stop talking and listen. And that's what's going to allow us to get to the next level. So that's something that I wanted to bring up. Now, as far as me, the reason that I decided that I was going to run for office, and again, this is going to be something that's not news to any of you guys, after the primaries, I was kind of cynical and angry. So, again, I'm sure that this is something that we can all agree about. There were some folks, Dem Exit, some folks that were Dem Enter, there were, you know, just all these different movements, but the fact of the matter is, all that we wanted was something new. And that's why we're here. Despite, you know, it's, you know, we've got TSA, we've got, you know, PDA, MPA, we've got all these different groups here coming together. Despite the fact that we have all these different groups, we're here for one thing. We want things to change, and we don't want incrementalism anymore. So basically what I'm saying is that we need to, once we leave here, this is not where it stops, this is where it starts. And I know that I'm stealing that line from Bernie in a way. But, you know, there's the app that we have that has all the attendees' names and stuff on it to keep in touch. And I'm going to steal a page out of Bernie's book. If you look up Alan Pugh in that app, you can actually find my campaign website. But that's a good way to keep in touch with each other as well. So I encourage everybody to put their email address and their profile in on the app so you guys can stay in touch with each other once we get out of here. Because this is where it starts.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. So next, we're getting so many people here, I can't keep track of all these names. It's fantastic. Next is Liano Sharon.
Hi everybody, my name is Leano Sharon, I'm from Ypsilanti, Michigan. I'm with a group called Michigan for Revolution. Some of you guys are here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we did and some of the things we learned, or some of the lessons I've taken from it. So first of all, we started organizing in December. We brought nearly 1,000 people to the State Democratic Convention. We won a number of seats on the State Central Committee. We brought a number of resolutions and forced them to do a line-by-line review of the rules. We now have, we're now on that committee doing the line-by-line review of the rules, and this stuff can happen. We're making it happen. I want to share a couple of lessons from that organizing. Going around getting people to join the Democratic Party was often very hard, especially actually among more radical people like us here. The response I typically got was, if I join the Democratic Party, then I'm a Democrat. I'm not sure I want to be a Democrat. And I see that a lot with the way that different groups, will form over here and we'll have in the same city, we'll have four or five different groups that are all basically like the last speaker just said, after the same kind of results, but are really divided up. And I think that one key thing that we have to think about is how our culture teaches us to think about what it means to join a group. And what I started telling people is I said, look, in an authoritarian culture, when you join a group, you become like the group. That's the authoritarian way of thinking about joining a group. In a democratic culture, when you join a group, they become more like you. Yes. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to make the Democratic Party more like us when we're done measuring. And we're trying to make them more like us, not only from the inside, but also from the outside. We have a new informational environment. We have a new social environment where we can have multiple groups, multiple parties working together without having to worry about who's in which or how they're fighting. We need to stop that fighting. We need to say, I haven't done this with the groups in Michigan yet, but I've started to reach out to them to do this in July. When you go around to the DSA, for example, and the PDA and all of the rest of these organizations, and I'm going to say, you know what? We need people on the outside of the Democratic Party, and we need people on the inside of the Democratic Party. And you know what? If you're a Green, if you're a PDA, if you're a DSA, that doesn't mean you can't join the Democratic Party. In Michigan, there is no charge to join the Democratic Party, and you don't have to show up to anything to be able to vote in the state convention. So, for example, I've made this pitch to a bunch of DSA people. Show up once every 2 years. Join the party. It's free. You'll know what we're doing because we're broadcasting what we're doing. Let's not be divided about this. We'll support DSA candidates. We've said to the Democratic Party, we've said, just because we joined doesn't mean you get our vote. It's not automatic. You have to run a candidate that we're going to support. We're going to support a different candidate. And that might be a Green candidate or a DSA candidate or an independent candidate. And when you come to us and you say, but you're going to split the vote, we'll say, fine, your candidate can get out. If you do it to us, people do all the time and say, you're going to split the vote, why don't you, your candidate should leave? The same goes for your side. The Democratic Party is not the default. In a democratic society, it's not the default. And I want to emphasize this thing about a democratic culture and a democratic society. One of the key weights of history that we live under is the myth of American democracy. We were not founded as a democracy. We were not founded as a democratic republic. We were founded as a plutocratic oligarchy with a republic for the oligarchs. In the first election of this country, 1.8% of the people got to vote. When they were trying to get out of England, out from under England, they said that legitimate government comes from the consent of the governed. But they didn't write that into the Constitution because they didn't want black people's consent because they were going to enslave them. They knew that already. They didn't want women's consent because they weren't going to give them the vote. They didn't want Native American consent. They didn't want any of that. Okay? So, We learn in our schools, they tell us about how genius they were with three branches of government, checks and balances, all of that, and we're told that this is wonderful. We don't ask how many of those branches you get to vote for. You get to vote for none of them equally. You don't get to vote for president, that's the Electoral College. It's only 104 years since we've been able to elect senators directly, but we don't have equal representation. In Michigan, we have 10 million people, we get two senators, Wyoming has six. Yep. Wyoming has 600,000. They get two. If we were equally represented, we would get 16. California would get 65. Okay. Gerrymandering. It was coined in 1812, but it's been with us since the Constitution was written, and they started doing it in the first election. So we don't get to choose our representatives. We do not have a democracy, and we have to stop thinking that we do. And we have to burst the myth, because when we go and we want to change the system, people think they're fighting us because they're defending democracy, and they're not. They're defending an authoritarianism that was designed to suppress black people and minorities.
Speaker is going to be Carlos Jesus. He is the president of the Young Progressives of America.
Can I hear some noise for the political revolution? My name is Carlos Jesus. I am the president of Young Progressives of America. I worked on Bernie Sanders' campaign in Miami. I was a field organizer for Tim Kaine for Congress. to give a shout out to the Bernie family in Miami and Tim Canova. You guys have impacted my life, and the experiences with you guys, I hold true to my heart. So thank you very much. Bernie ignited the fires of a political revolution that will transform our society for generations. It also has transformed the lives of many people here. Many people were on career paths that they just dropped. To join in this fight for a better world. Now, many of you will not know this, even the people that know me, but a few days after the Bernie rally in Miami, I turned down a contract to play soccer professionally, to join this revolution. I decided to stay in Miami, apply for college, and work on Bernie's campaign, and then on Tim's campaign, because I believe that we can make a society where everyone has a decent life, where everyone's life is respected. Now, right now we are living in historic times. We are living in revolutionary times, but we are also out of time. Right after Tim's campaign, I went to college in New York, and on my first day, I saw 400 professors locked out by the administration at our school. This was the first time in American history that a higher education institution had suffered a lockout. Now, of course, I sprang to action and did what I knew I had to do. I had to prevent this lockout from succeeding, because that would set a blueprint to other universities on how to try to destroy labor and keep attacking higher education. Now, we organized for 2 weeks nonstop protests, walkouts, sit-ins, until we defeated that lockout. Then, of course, we kept organizing. We kept putting up the pressure on that administration, because it's a microcosm of what's happening all across America. Then Donald Trump became president. Something that many of us did not expect. But now we're seeing how dangerous it is. There are forces in our society that do not see the country that we live in as a country of inclusivity. A country where everyone deserves a decent living wage. Now in January, I founded an organization. That is YPA. And our goal is for young people to collectively wield political power in order to implement the progressive agenda in America. Yep. Young people in America right now have the power to make the change that we need. So what we did to be able to fight back against the administration and solidify this power is that we took over the student government. We swept the election over a month ago at the student government elections. We organized. We had Facebook ads targeted at students. We had 15 to 20 students that rotated schedules, having person-to-person conversations, passing out literature with a message of transforming SGA, of change, and of protecting higher education. Now, I know everyone here is young at heart, but us young people are oppressed by class, gender, and race. We're also oppressed by student debt, by a climate catastrophe, by a dysfunctional government. It is our time to rise. It is a pressing issue that all of you support us in our fight to take power and to achieve a liberation of a generation that will save the society. Because I do believe that our generation is able to make that change so we can leave a future for our kids, for our grandkids, and for years to come. Now, as Martin Luther King said, freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed. And right now, we're in a fight. The establishment will not give in. It never will. We are up against the most powerful establishment in the history of mankind. The biggest military and the most amount of money. But we have the people. And we will continue fighting. And I really feel inspired seeing so many people come together for a common goal of making this a liberal society, one which treats everyone in a fair way. Now I would like to ask, of course, the support of all the young people that are running for office. And not so young people too.
Good.
Because young people will support people like Bernie Sanders, who is the awesome cool grandpa that has inspired us. But we also do need young people in power, because our generation needs to solidify power to fight back against a regressive right-wing agenda. Republicans are two states away from calling a constitutional convention. This is not said enough in the media. This is very scary. We're going to have repercussions that can last for generations in our society. We cannot let that happen. But I have hope. Because momentum is on our side, like we saw in the UK with Jeremy Corbyn. And with Bernie in America, times are changing. Thank you very much. Our website is ypamerica.org. Our website, we have a soft launch, it'll be officially launched at the end of next week. Our Twitter and Instagram is ypa_org. And yeah, our Facebook is Young Progressives of America. Please like and support us. And any student, young person that also wants to join, and not so young people that wants to support us, please talk to me. Thank you very much. Let's do this. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can.
Sprechen Sie Deutsch. The next speaker is Anna Callahan.
Incorruptibles. I was a software developer. I quit my job during the Bernie campaign to volunteer full time. I never went back. I ended up leading a group of about 200 volunteers in Berkeley, California. And in the November, in the elections in November, we focused on local politics. We called through our lists over and over for weeks, getting people to canvass for a slate of progressives. For mayor, for city council, with public financing elections on the ballot. And that the night of November 8th, we were celebrating Jesse Aragin and all of those city council members who won. We won public financing elections. We won everything. We were hooting and hollering. We were having a great time because the presidential campaign had not been decided yet. And we all went home to realize, oh my God, what happened? But the point being that in our locality, in our local elections, we won everything. It was an incredible experience. And so what we've done now is we formed a group called The Incorruptibles. So what The Incorruptibles does is we've actually been working with the Richmond Progressive Alliance. How many people have heard of the Richmond Progressive Alliance? Great, some people. A short story, the town, the city of Richmond, California, was owned by Chevron. There's a Chevron refinery there. It was owned by Chevron for 100 years. Chevron literally had a desk in City Hall. They paid off all the politicians, terrible environmental devastation, terrible health problems, failing schools, abusive police department, second highest murder rate in the country, a very troubled city. And in 2003, the Richmond Progressive Alliance decided that they were going to take over their city government, and they have spent the last 13 years doing that. They had a green mayor for 8 years who turned everything around. They now have a super majority on the city council. And I can tell you the story of like what the city is like now, but they've essentially completely turned around their city. And you would be amazed at how much you can protect your residents from the circus that is our national politics by controlling your city government. There are a ton of things that we can do by owning local politics. So the Incorruptibles has a guide that can help you in any city do exactly what the Richmond Progressive Alliance did, take over your city government. The model that they have developed is really transformative because not only do they work inside and outside of politics, so they form coalitions, they march with other groups, they, you know, they're on strike with unions, they you know, join in these other movements. So it's not just candidates. But they also run a slate of candidates. So they form a team in the city that will learn from every campaign, whether it's won or lost, that will gain name recognition, will continue to learn from and educate their constituents year after year after year. And this is the true grassroots organizing that we need to do. So what the Incorruptibles does, in addition to having a guide, kind of like the Indivisible Guide, that lets anyone in any city form an Incorruptibles chapter, and to be Incorruptibles, you have to, number one, take no corporate money, and number two, yes, super important, number two, while your candidates can be affiliated with a party, your group cannot affiliate itself with a party. Because when we play that game, we either affiliate ourselves with a party that must lose or with a party that must be corrupt. And we're not playing that game anymore. That's their game. They can keep it. We're not going to play it anymore. Run your candidates as whatever you want, but form your team that has its own platform and its own, you know, name and its own affiliation. So you get known in your community for what you represent, not what the Democrats represent, not what the Green Party, as good as they may be, represents. And we also provide technology tools that are open source, so no one is going to have access to your data but you. It's not under the control of any corporation or of you being able to be turned over to the government, God forbid. And we also provide a network so that we can all across America, we can communicate with each other and learn from each other's campaigns. So I welcome you to not only think about starting an Incorruptibles team in your city locally, but joining our national team. We're completely grassroots team, currently 100% volunteer, and anyone who wants to join will have a voice. We don't have like a paid national staff that makes the strategic decisions and hands down volunteer activities. You are us. We are you. And so join our national team and be involved in all the strategic decisions that we have. Be involved in everything that we do. We need your help, and we're here to support you. Thank you so much.
Next speaker is going to be Nick Brown. Nick. Hurry up here. Nick. Hello, Nick. Let's go. A lot of time. Nick, you're not to skip Nick right now. Joy, please. Joy. Yay. Joy is a professional speaker. So we know that. Joy is a tremendous courage for her to speak. I know she's a little nervous, but give it up for Joy, please.
So I'm walking away with a box sandwich, and I see this beautiful man come towards me. Hey, Joy.
and I'm fangirling, like, what's going on? So that was kind of weird. This whole weekend has been amazing and surreal, and woo! Probably the best weekend of my life, honestly. Just like a super quick backstory, I started campaigning for Bernie. Like, that was my first, you know, experience with politics, like many people. Door knocking and phone banking and organizing marches and voter registration drives, all while working full time and going to school. So I was kind of dedicated. but after the election, I was not dumb. He planted that seed in me. I just wasn't finished. I still had fury. I still wanted to make a change and make a difference. So I became an activist. I'm from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania area. And I have a ride or die co, Catherine, who her and I just do all kinds of events. We've done marches and rallies and protests for no DAPL and healthcare and all kinds of things. I just did one for Flint last weekend. And we did one for immigrant solidarity. And for some just like bananas reason, we got almost 1,000 people. For people who are not part of a group, like, we're literally just two average citizens who do this in our spare time. It was really amazing. And I just want to leave you guys with something I always say at the end of our events. Trump tries to divide us, but he inadvertently has united us in some ways. And he's scary, you know, in many ways. But this right here makes Trump fear us.
Yes.
So thank you all so much for being here.
That was pretty wonderful. What if it's a joy, you know, talks about, this is one of the issues I think is here. You can only consent to feeling inferior, and this is an extremely important point. People have to understand that. What happens psychologically is some people, you know, feel judged, they feel ultimately that somehow they're not enough or whatever the case. And understand, as long as you believe in yourself, I know it's cheesy, you'll be fine. So I mean, it's a really extraordinary important point. So I know Nick just gave me the room, but let me just quickly get Tom Wells in here first. So Tom, please.
Thank you. We're progressives, that means we got issues. Well, I'm going to add a couple of more issues because some people require different strokes. So here's one I've not heard before that I think is worthwhile if you're ever talking to veterans or if you ever care about our country and its military policy. Imagine that. Yes, here it is. Here's how I talk to veterans. I tell them what I am going to do will be to seek a ban on military contractors in war zones.
Yeah.
Now, this saves money, this saves lives, and this stops the egregious creation of terrorists, because the mission of military contractors is to go and kill randomly and rape people and create the next generation of terrorists. So, this plays really well to terrorists or anyone who cares about the military adventurism and capitalistic, imperialistic system that we need to defeat. So this is a simple example of one of the issues that we need to talk to that has never, in my hearing, been addressed. It is but one specimen of the overall program of privatization of those things which should be social functions. They want to privatize the military by having mercenaries go and do a really shitty job of it. They want to privatize our water supply by first poisoning it and saying, well, civil works, the government never works. Well, if you hire somebody who says the government does a bad job, they will fulfill that campaign promise. Yeah, big deal. Okay? I have a question for the group. Can we win by playing defense?
No.
Well, I see too many cases where we look at an issue and we're against NAFTA and TPP. These guys are zombies. They will never be withdrawn from the field. What we have to do is attack with an option. I have never seen anybody, I've never gotten anyone to talk to me about developing fair trade policies. Where if our company has to face environmental protection rules, and of course we're getting rid of those, then tariffs should be applied to anybody who's trying to produce it in another country and does not require those safety rules, those union rules, those environmental rules, and which is not paying the social costs of their product. So let's build an offense. That's one example. I got more, but I'm let you guys get back to your home states and start doing the work we're talking about.
No. I want to let you guys come back because we're going to talk a little bit. But I think Ray, enough. You guys can stay a little longer. I'm actually going to be here until Monday. You know, I think it's really important. This is just an extraordinary crowd. So,
get my website. Of course. Forget me. I'm not playing the politician very well. TomWellsForCongress.com. Issues are not complete. Tom Wells for Congress on Facebook. Thank you very much.
That's actually what Tom is, an excellent politician. He believes in the people, not himself. That's really good. Appreciate it. All right, please. Okay. All right, come on here. We'll do this a little bit unconventional.
I also forgot to say our URL because it's theincorruptibles.us.
All right, next, please give it up for Nick Brown.
Hello, everyone. Hey, so I'm Nick. I started with so many, with some of the wonderful faces in here, the movement to draft Bernie for a new party. All right, yeah. Talk a little bit about what to me was the most important lesson from the campaign, from Bernie's incredible revolutionary campaign. Because I think if we truly embrace that lesson, it's going to radically change, reorient the way that we approach what we're doing as a movement. It is still not very well understood, I think, even among progressives, how incredible, how remarkable Bernie's campaign was as an achievement. He started off with no money, no name recognition, 3% nationally, running against a household name, elder stateswoman, one of the most well-known people in the world. He had, the media was against him, the party establishment was against him. He was running against an anointed candidate. All he had was that revolutionary, progressive message and his integrity. In fact, he'd been saying the same thing in those YouTube clips for 35 years. Now, here's what's really profound about that. Those two things in 1 year, in the one year that he ran, those two things overcame all the traditional political forces. That political scientists, the media, the pundits, everybody's going to tell you, Washington's going to tell you, that's what determines, you know. The consultants, oh no, that's all it takes. It's just a function of who has, you know, the most of that, and you plug in X and Y, and, you know, comes out with who's going to win by how much. Well, Bernie just proved that. And he showed that there is a force more powerful than that, and it is that integrity. And it is that revolutionary progressive message. And really that when we take on both establishment parties in the way that he did on the campaign, that's when we win. That's when we do best. We don't need all of those other things. What we need is we need to stay true to the message that we have. On the campaign, everybody understood that a party that takes corporate money is not a people's party. We all knew we called Hillary out for those speeches that she gave, Goldman Sachs, all the money she took, $6 million checks from George Soros. You know, we called her out for that. Well, with that, we have to keep that in mind now. That party, just like we knew it back then, it is still true today. The party that still takes that corporate money is still not going to be a people's party. And let me tell you, I lobbied the superdelegates for Bernie, and that money is not, it's not like a little tumor, you're going to go in there and you're going to cut it out. That it runs through the party's veins. It is written into the party's DNA. You've got to push on. There's nothing left if you try to take that out. There's nothing left of the party. There's basically nothing left. But that brings me to why I'm here today with so many great comrades. And that is because we have a better option now. We have a better option today than we've had before. Because we have someone who already built a progressive party. Bernie Sanders did it. He did it during the primaries. He popularized a progressive message. He put together a progressive coalition. He built the national volunteer infrastructure. He built the national fundraising infrastructure. That's a party, folks. That's a party. That's a party. It's our party. Our party. So we don't have to do this anymore. We don't have to bang our head against the corporate Democrats. We don't have to bang our head against the establishment parties. So we've got a party. All we've got to do is we've got to get Bernie on board, and we've got to sign the paperwork, and we're on our way, and we're going to take over. That's what it takes. Thank you, everyone. It's been a wonderful reception.
Now we're dead to be Sean Spicer for a day. So what we're going to do is we individually, if everyone wants to come up and talk, but what we need to do is we have to ask some very tough questions. And it's not necessarily right now up the Republican Party. It's up progressives and it's up Democrats. So what I would like to do at this point in time is just have people kind of talk about any concerns, frustrations, anxiety people are having about the Progressive Party or the Democrats. Please.
Well, my question is.
Can we put a mic there? Yes, go ahead.
Well,
just turn it on.
So, regarding the Russia issue. I think many of us join the rest of the world in sort of not taking the Russia fear as seriously as some people in our Congress are taking it. And when Bernie discusses it and he talks about the Russia fear, some of us feel like, oh, Bernie, we don't really understand that. So could you shed some light on that?
Absolutely, and I really appreciate that question. That's one of the elephants in the room. And I'm not Bernie Sanders, nor do I play one on TV. But I can tell you something, guys. This is a great discussion. This is an issue that we got to be very, very careful about. Talk about alternative news, Donald Trump, we talk about South the Republican Party. We got to deal with that in terms of the Progressive Party. So what I want to try to understand before we go any further, how many people think that Russia is a serious problem in terms of what's going on and the fact of whether or not Russia interfered in this election? All right, raise your hand. Okay. All right, so it sounds like a lot of people do. And the reality is Russia did play a role. Now, by the same token as Nina Turner, talked about whatever like that. We have very significant problems at home. And so the reality is, while it is an important issue, the Comey issue is an important issue, the bigger issue ultimately is that we now have a situation where my minimum wage is $7.25 an hour, where the Affordable Care Act, if it's gutted, is going to leave 23 million Americans with no health insurance. I can go on and on to talk about the issue, so I absolutely agree wholeheartedly, but please understand that Russia did meddle in the United States elections, and we have to understand that. That is absolutely true.
I'm sorry, so
we deposed the elected government of Honduras under Obama with Hillary.
No, wait a second. I studied Central Latin American history, so I understand full well how outrageous the United States has been from the beginning. There's no debate. But we have to understand that democracy is fragile. And the simple fact is that regardless of where, you know, what's going on here, we have to understand, you know, that we have to hold people accountable. We have to be careful about what's going on in terms of the world.
This is a very divisive thing I think that we're talking about right now.
Well, you know what? That's a really interesting question.
Was a real problem.
Yeah.
So, you know, look, it's hard to facilitate. Wonderful and awesome, and I love you.
And I appreciate the back and forth. This is exactly what we have to do.
So far, and I don't really pay much attention to it, to be honest, because I think we have so many more important issues. But my experience so far is that the meddling in the election specifically, now there's all sorts of corruption going on with Russia. I'm more than happy to talk about that. But the election specifically was letting us know how corrupt the Democratic Party is, and frankly, I'm whoever did that, and I'm not convinced it was the Russians, I am glad that they did.
We need to protect our elections from the corrupt people in our own country.
Yes. Yes. They have open source voting machines, if they have open choice voting, if they have our voting machines on your 24-hour video, okay, if we secure our election system and make a constitutional amendment for secure elections, then we don't have to worry about Russia or Hillary or like the Ron Paul.